Me first.
Okay, you silly gavel. Why the hurry?
I've just decided it's more fun to be first. At everything.
Oh?
Yes. First in line. First to finish my lunch. First place.
I see. But don't you like enjoying your food when you eat?
I do.
And what about the old adage, good things come to those who wait?
I don't know.
Well, think about it.
Hey, you tricked me.
Not on purpose.
Well, okay. So, what are we going to learn about today?
Well, given your current state of mind, why don't we start at the beginning?
Okay, the beginning. As in?
As in the first significant case heard by the Supreme Court.
First? Really?
Well, not the actual first case, but the first case to make a significant impact.
I'm in. Hey, where are you going so fast?
The court is already in session. Let's not be late.
Oh, no. I was hoping to sit in the front row.
Not today.
This is a case of uncommon magnitude.
Who's that?
Justice James Wilson of the Supreme Court and one of the founding fathers of this country.
What does that mean? A founding father?
It means he either signed the Declaration of Independence or helped draft the U.S. Constitution. In this case, he did both.
Wow, cool. And what's he talking about?
Shh, let's listen and find out.
The question to be determined is whether this state, so respectable, and whose claim soars so high, is amenable to the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of the United States.
What state is he talking about?
Georgia.
Why? What did they do?
Refuse to pay a bill.
What? Oh, sorry.
Let's go out in the hall.
That was weird. Everybody could hear us.
Well, it's a day for firsts.
Were those Supreme Court justices?
Yes, those were the original Supreme Court justices from 1790.
The first?
Yes. John Jay, John Blair, James Wilson, James Iredell, and William Cushing. Everyone was there. Well, except for John Rutledge, who had resigned from the court in 1791.
Wow. What case were they discussing?
Chisholm versus Georgia.
And what was that all about?
In 1777, Robert Farquhar sold his goods to the state of Georgia to be used during the Revolutionary War. However, Farquhar never got paid. After Farquhar died, the executor of his estate, Alexander Chisholm, brought suit against the state of Georgia to recover the debt. Chisholm, who was from Charleston, South Carolina, sought 100,000 pounds of silver to recover the debt and interest.
And did he get it?
Well, let's find out.
Do the people of the United States... Do the people of the United States form a nation?
It's so exciting to see some of the founding fathers in action. Oh, there's Justice Iredell. He was the lone dissenter in the Supreme Court. He said that under common law, each state is sovereign and cannot be sued without their consent. There's Edmund Randolph, Mr. Chisholm's attorney, and the U.S. Attorney General.
Phew! The silence was too much to bear. Okay, questions. What is common law?
Laws derived from judicial decisions rather than statutes.
Why was the Attorney General arguing the case?
I don't know.
And why didn't the state just pay the debt in the first place?
Some say it was because Farquhar was a British loyalist. Others speculate that the state treasury was struggling to pay Revolutionary War debt. Whatever the reason, Georgia's governor, Edward Telfair, made it clear he did not believe the Supreme Court had jurisdiction over the matter by refusing to send counsel to argue the case.
Oh, wow. So, without a defense team present, what did the court do?
They entered a default judgment in favor of Chisholm.
What is that?
A default judgment is like a forfeit victory in sports. If the other team doesn't show up, you win.
So, not to be rude, I don't understand why this was such a big deal. The state didn't show up. The court ruled in the guy's favor. The guy got his money, right?
Yes, eventually the state legislature in Georgia appropriated funds to pay the debt.
Okay, bada bing, bada boom, right?
Well, not exactly. Do you remember that lone dissenter?
Yeah, Justice Iredell.
Right. Well, his sole opinion apparently struck a chord with Congress, which quickly drafted the 11th Amendment.
And what did that say?
The 11th Amendment basically guarantees sovereign immunity for states, so they cannot be sued in federal court without their consent.
Wait, wasn't that the very right the court just denied them?
Yes, it was. Congress wanted to make sure that a case like this would never make it to the Supreme Court again.
So, even though Justice Iredell's dissent didn't change the outcome of the Chisholm case, it did influence the direction of the U.S. Constitution in a big way, right?
For hundreds of years, the 11th Amendment has shielded states from most money damage actions brought against them.
Justice Iredell must be so proud!
Like I said, good things come to those who wait.
Let me think about that for a second. Nah, I still like being first. Hey, how would you like to be the first to choose which case we're going to learn about next? Pick something! Hurry!